Hello, I'm Dr. Richard Dufour, the principal of Adlai Stevenson High School in Lake County, Illinois, and co-author of Fulfilling the Promise of Excellence, A Practitioner's Guide to School Improvement. This program is designed to accomplish two objectives. The first is to suggest the assumptions which should guide curriculum development and monitoring. The second is to demonstrate a particular process for monitoring the effectiveness of any given curriculum. Let's begin, though, by considering the following observations. Effective organizations are obsessed with outcomes, with results. They set a focus and stick to the knitting. Innovative companies have a focus that becomes a catalytic force, an organizing principle. Effective organizations have a fixation with, an undeviating attention to outcomes. Notice the consistency of the conclusions of these three independent studies. Each cites the importance of focused attention, of having a fixation upon particular outcomes. Now compare those conclusions with the findings of Ernest Boyer, who completed a study of secondary schooling in America. Boyer wrote, "High schools lack a clear and vital mission. They are unable to find common purposes or establish educational priorities that are widely shared. They seem unable to put it all together. The institution is adrift." Boyer's observation should be a matter of concern to all of us who hope to provide quality education in our secondary schools. Of course, the reason that high schools may appear to be adrift is that they're asked to be all things to all people, to solve every social problem and embrace every special interest. For example, in one Midwestern state, every school in the state is required by law to provide instruction in air pollution, water pollution, use of pesticides, preservation of wilderness areas, forest management, protection of wildlife, and humane care of domestic animals. Each school is required to hold appropriate exercises tending to show the value of trees and birds and to commemorate Leif Erikson and the principles and ideals which he fostered. The same year that the state presented the schools with over 3,000 outcomes that students were to achieve by 10th grade, the state asked the schools to set aside time from their instructional day to allow every student in the state to participate in the election of the state fish. They also mandated that schools close one day each year in order to commemorate the birthday of Casimir Pulaski, who, by the way, never set foot in the state. High schools have been sent mixed messages. They've been told, pay attention to everything. Everything is important. And thus have often been unable to establish a clear focus. One of America's foremost philosophers, Yogi Berra, is credited with saying, if you don't know where you're going, you probably aren't going to get there. Establishing a sense of focus, a clear sense of where we are going, is one of the most pressing curricular needs in America's secondary schools today. Perhaps you've heard the adage that there are three rules to follow in the purchase of real estate. The first is location, the second, location, and the third, location. If that maxim were applied to schools, the three rules of curriculum development are focus, focus, and focus. This generalization was found to be true at the school level by researchers such as Ron Edmonds, who found that in effective schools, there were clear goals and educational priorities that were widely understood. The generalization was also found to be true at the school level. Jerry Brophy summarized the research on effective teaching by saying, the main difference between effective and ineffective teachers is that effective teachers know what it is they are trying to accomplish and thus are able to monitor their progress more or less continuously. The fact that teachers and schools should have a clear curricular focus is the first and most significant assumption which guides the curriculum development and monitoring process I'm about to describe. The second assumption is that the appropriate focus for secondary schools is student outcomes. Schools serve many functions, but their basic purpose is to see to it that students acquire certain cognitive, affective, and psychomotor outcomes. In simpler terms, students should acquire certain knowledge, attitudes, and skills as they proceed through school, and that acquisition should be the primary concern of schools and their staffs. A third assumption is that the principal is responsible both for seeing to it that faculty and students focus on outcomes and for monitoring the results of their efforts. This responsibility can and should be shared with others, teachers, department chairmen, and so on. But in the final analysis, primary responsibility remains with the principal and cannot be relegated to others. A fourth assumption which guides the process is that the appropriate level for monitoring is the individual classroom. General achievement or aptitude tests, such as the ACT or SAT, are of no significant bearing upon the individual classroom teacher. Every course should include student outcomes that are specific to that course, and an effort should be made to assess student achievement of those outcomes at the classroom level. A fifth assumption which guides this process is that leaders communicate the importance of an area by paying attention to it. When Robert Waterman, the co-author of In Search of Excellence, was asked, "How does a leader communicate values of an organization to those within it?" his answer was succinct: "Attention is all there is." Let me attempt to illustrate Waterman's point by sharing the experience of a junior high school staff with which I am familiar. At the opening of the school year faculty meeting, the principal announced that the district had set a goal of improving student scores on standardized achievement tests. He vigorously urged each teacher to embrace that goal and make a personal commitment to raising student scores. As an aside, he mentioned that during the previous year, the faculty had relied on the Xerox machine just too darn much, way beyond the district average, and he shared his plan for resolving the copier crisis with the staff. A logbook would be kept near the Xerox machine at all times. Teachers would be required to log in their names, the number of copies made, and a brief explanation as to why they were using the Xerox rather than a Ditto Master each time they used the machine. Each week, the principal secretary would record the information from the logbook on a master chart, which the principal would analyze. If a faculty member's use of the Xerox was excessive in the judgment of the principal, he would counsel with the teacher. The principal was true to his word. A logbook was kept at the machine. His secretary did keep a master chart, and he did in fact analyze that chart and call teachers in when, in his judgment, they'd been excessive in their use of the copier. He tried to serve as an example to the staff by printing his memos on Ditto Masters. And from time to time, he announced the reduction in Xerox materials and congratulated the staff in the progress that they were making. That spring, he returned the results of student performance on standardized tests to teachers without comment. It's my conviction that this principal did an excellent job of conveying what was important to him that year. Not test scores, but reducing reliance upon the copier. That's what he monitored, that's what he planned for, that's what he modeled, that's what he confronted, and that's what he celebrated. In short, that's what he paid attention to. Time is one of the most precious resources available to a principal. And when a staff sees that a principal is devoting a great deal of his or her time to monitoring student outcomes, the importance of those outcomes is conveyed in a clear and unequivocal manner. In short, it is attention, not exhortation, which communicates most powerfully. The curriculum development and monitoring process itself is fairly straightforward. First, an entire department agrees upon a general goal or goals that should drive daily instruction. For example, a social studies department might say that they want all students to understand the historical, political, economic, and social factors which have shaped the American nation and its people. Next, a team of teachers responsible for teaching a specific course convenes to identify 10 to 12 intended outcomes for that course for each semester. For example, all teachers teaching U.S. history might decide that they want students to be able to identify examples of economic conditions which played a major influence in American history in the 19th century. The teaching team then becomes more specific still, as they write a number of objectives for each outcome. For example, they might say, students will be able to compare and contrast economic conditions in the North and South, which contributed to sectionalism in the 1850s. Notice the increasing specificity as the team moves from departmental goal to course outcome to unit objective. Next, the teacher team develops a course description which states the general goal for the department, lists the outcomes that students are to achieve that semester, and provides a brief explanation as to how students will be evaluated. This description is provided to all students within the first 5 days of the semester. The teacher team then writes a common, comprehensive, criterion-referenced final examination, making sure that it has at least 8 to 10 items for each of the course outcomes. The team examines items with national norms from such sources as the National Assessment of Educational Progress or the ACT exam. When an item from one of these nationally normed sources serves as an appropriate measure for a particular course outcome, the team may decide to include it on their exam. Thus, the exam that they create meets the standards of an ideal test in that it is locally developed, curriculum-based, criterion-referenced, and at least in part, nationally normed. The test is administered as a required final examination for all students who complete the course. Then, utilizing Scantron equipment and microcomputers, the tests are analyzed and the results are shared with each teacher who taught the course. The teacher receives an analysis which identifies how all students who completed the course scored on each item, on the total test, and on subtests within the test. Teachers are free to identify as many subtests as they desire. Generally, subtests are created for each outcome, each unit, and for the nationally normed items. Individual teachers also receive an analysis of how their students performed on each item, each subtest, and the total test. They also receive data indicating how students in the past had performed on the exam. Since students are assigned to classes randomly, teachers have the benefit of comparing how their students performed compared to similar students taking the identical course. The longitudinal data enables them to assess how their students performed compared to students in the past. Finally, after teachers have had some time to analyze the data, they meet as a team to identify particular items or outcomes in which student performance failed to meet anticipated levels of proficiency. The team then develops strategies for making improvements and shares their findings with the department chairman and principal. I can tell you from firsthand experience that a school derives many benefits from this curriculum monitoring process. First, it helps teachers to present focused instruction. Teachers know what they are to teach and students are to learn. The process helps all teachers to clarify what they are to accomplish and to plan purposeful lessons, two prerequisites for effective teaching. Second, the process has ensured a core curriculum for all students. In many schools, what students are taught is a reflection upon the interest and idiosyncrasies of their teachers rather than any common core curriculum. In such schools, students taking the identical course with different teachers can be exposed to widely different experiences and subject matter. This curriculum monitoring process discourages that tendency. It rests upon the twin beliefs that teachers should be able to identify the essence or core of any course that they teach. And once that core is identified, that all students have access to it, regardless of who is teaching the course. A third benefit is that the process helps students to focus upon the significant outcomes of their courses. As students ourselves, we've probably all had the experience of walking into an examination, not knowing for sure what we were to have learned, and hoping that we had guessed correctly. Students shouldn't have to guess what they are to learn. This process advises them of the specific course outcomes at the very outset of the course, and those outcomes serve as an excellent means of review at the time of final examinations. Fourth, the process results in better tests. Teachers are able to review and critique each question and each descriptor that appears on the exam. They recognize that every test item they submit will come under the scrutiny of their peers, and they tend to write better items. Fifth, The process provides the school with the ability to identify curriculum areas needing attention. As teacher teams review the analysis of student performance, they can identify those items or outcomes in which that performance failed to meet anticipated levels. With this information in hand, the team can begin to make informed instructional decisions, deciding to give more attention to a particular area, revising the pacing or sequencing of the course, changing materials, clarifying test items, and so on. Sixth, the process gives individual teachers an external indicator of their performance. You know, teaching has been referred to as the second most private act in which adults engage. All too often, teachers go about their tasks isolated from other adults and devoid of the contact and feedback that they need in order to improve. I recall interviewing a physics teacher with over 20 years of experience. And I asked him, "You're a scientist. Give me some data, some evidence that you've been an effective teacher." After thinking about my question for some time, he said, "I can't give you any evidence." Occasionally, a student will come back from college and will tell me that my classes helped them in college, but I really have no way of knowing how my students perform compared to other students of physics in the district or the state or the nation. I'm convinced that his answer represents not an aberration, but the norm for high school teachers in America. We tell teachers, improve, be excellent. But it's difficult to improve when one has to operate in a vacuum. This process gives each teacher the opportunity to assess how his or her students performed on each item, each subtest, and the total test compared to similar students, former students, and students from a national sample. This information not only spurs efforts to improve, it provides the insight necessary to make those improvement efforts fruitful. Finally, both the small team approach and the comparison of individual performance with group norms that characterize this process have been cited as extremely effective motivators. Terry Deal and Alan Kennedy, the authors of Corporate Culture, consider the small team approach as the most powerful motivator in post-industrial America, because it exerts a subtle peer pressure on each individual to contribute to the achievement of team goals. Furthermore, psychologists tell us that we are wildly irrational about ourselves. All of us, including teachers, tend to think we're pretty terrific, and virtually no one describes himself or herself as below average. Thus, when a teacher is confronted with student scores which indicate that their student's performance is below the district or the school or the national average, that teacher is almost inevitably compelled to try and raise those scores. In short, this process is a tremendous motivator. Let's consider some of the questions that are frequently raised by those considering this process. First, does the fact that criterion reference tests are best suited to objective items mean that the school will ignore other important areas of learning? This is an excellent question. Criterion reference tests are not well suited to assess all areas of student learning. For example, every high school wants students to be able to write clearly and coherently. The best means of assessing student writing is not criterion reference tests, but holistic scoring of writing samples or evaluation of student portfolios of writing that have been collected over time. However, some educators seem to take the position that because criterion reference testing is not well suited to all of a school's goals, that it shouldn't be used to assess any of a school's goals. The school assessment program should certainly include a variety of components, but just as certainly, criterion reference testing should play a major role among those components. Another question that is frequently raised asks if the process is intended to rank or evaluate teachers. It most certainly is not. Ranking is pointless. If there are three teachers teaching the same course, it's almost a certainty that one of the three will have the lowest mean score, even if those teachers are Aristotle, Plato, and Socrates. Ranking teachers is not the point, and individual teachers are not provided with the test scores of their colleagues. Nor is the process used to evaluate teachers or to identify weak links. It is based on the assumption that professionals who are given valid feedback on their performance will be motivated to improve. In fact, I'm convinced that this information and this process serves as a much more effective motivator than the traditional means of teacher evaluation. Yet another question that often is asked is, won't teachers teach to the test? Now let's think about that one. If teachers have agreed that certain elements represent the core or essence of the course that they are teaching, and if they develop a test that represents a reliable, valid assessment of student mastery of that core, don't we want them to teach to the test? What else should they teach to? I'm not suggesting unethical behavior. What I am suggesting is purposeful instruction. In closing, let me offer two pieces of advice to those who hope to provide leadership in curriculum development and monitoring in their schools. In his Pulitzer Prize-winning book on leadership, James McGregor Burns concluded that the first step a leader must take if he hopes to influence others is to clarify his own goals. Remember the three rules of curriculum development: focus, focus, and focus. One of the most important acts of leadership you can provide is to help the school and its teachers clarify what is to be accomplished in each course. Finally, don't forget that you will convey the significance you place upon the curriculum development process by the time and effort you devote to monitoring student outcomes. After all, when it comes to conveying a sense of importance and priority to those within a school, attention is all there is. Thank you.